Welcome back to the virtual stage at Procurement Supply Chain Live London. Now we have a panel discussion for you now, and we're going to be looking at resilience and is it a game of multi-level chess? Sounds fascinating, and I'm sure it will be. And delighted to welcome on board a couple of speakers. First of all, we have Kevin Nelson. Kevin is Chief Procurement Officer and Senior Vice President at Becton Dickinson. Becton Dickinson, where he's responsible for managing third-party spend, supplier quality, real estate, construction, among other things. Before this, Kevin was VP of Global Strategic Sourcing at medical tech firm C.R. Bard, where he created its direct and indirect sourcing function. So welcome aboard, Kevin. And we also have Lynn Terrell, who is Chief Procurement and Supply Chain Officer at Flex, a global manufacturer across 30 nations. Flex offers digital technology innovation, supply chain and manufacturing solutions to numerous industries and markets. And at Flex, Lynn is responsible for direct and indirect materials, transportation, logistics, business operations, among other things. So welcome aboard, both of you.
Hello, Sean.
Thanks for having me.
Hello, Lynn. Hello, Kevin. So I'm intrigued by this title, Resilience is a Game of Multi-Level Chess. I wondered if maybe one of you could just give us a little flavor of what you mean by that. Maybe Lynn, would you like to start us off?
Sure. Pleasure to be here with you today. And when I think of a resilient supply chain, I think first I like to think back a little bit, because historically our supply chains were built on low cost and efficiencies. And now resiliency has come to the forefront as being really required to drive an organization forward. And when I think about a resilient supply chain, it really needs to be addressed across the product life cycle, from the design to manufacturing to distribution and logistics. So if you think about the design aspect, you can bring resiliency into your product at the very early stages when you're doing the design of a bill of materials by looking at designing in multi-source devices so that you have alternatives that are readily available to you. And if that's not an option because of a specific technology that's being used, then you can deploy different inventory strategies that can help mitigate any risk and drive a resilient supply chain. If you then look at the manufacturing piece, the second part, then you're looking at the options of a single sort location for manufacturing. Maybe it be to take advantage of, you know, scale and scope, or it may be that a multi-regional manufacturing strategy is more important for you so that you can be closer to your end market and mitigate risk. And finally, the logistics. Determining the most efficient and cost-effective solution while also taking into consideration what freight and logistics challenges you might encounter based upon those manufacturing and distribution strategies. So that's why I think when you're looking at a supply chain, it's not just one aspect. It's really every part of an end-to-end supply chain that needs to be considered in the design and deployment of that global supply chain.
Thanks for that, Lynn. And actually, Kevin, I was going to ask you, you know, if today supply chain needs to be like multi-level chess, what was it before the pandemic? Mm-hmm. What did it look like and how did it differ?
Yeah, I think I'd build on Lynn's comments a little bit too, in that, you know, prior to the pandemic, I think, you know, it was really for the most part a procurement initiative focused on, you know, managing your suppliers, making sure you had control of risk based on that. And I think what we've seen here with the pandemic is that you have to really look at the end to end. It's not about having a contract with the supplier. It's really, what are you doing from end to end, from designing a product in the new product development phase, all the way through, as Lynn said, through logistics as well. And that end to end coordination is really the chess game that we have to manage then effectively to make sure that you're you know, having a resilient supply chain.
So, I mean, resilience and agility, two words we just hear again and again when it comes to supply chain. Do you think, Lynn, that you know, those two words describe best the lessons that have been learnt over the last couple of years?
Well, I wouldn't say necessarily that they describe the past few years. I think the past few years have shown us that the desire of organizations is to build and deploy an agile and resilient supply chain. If I think of the past 2.5 years, one of the biggest lessons I've taken away from that is the fact that you can't predict every potential supply chain disruption and mitigate every activity, you know, mitigate any type of risk. There's always, you know, the business continuity plans and enterprise risk management that organizations look at and are very important, and now more so than ever before. But when I think about all of the disruptions we've encountered, there was just no way to potentially predict or mitigate from that. So I think the biggest lesson is the need to look at that and build in resilient strategies into a supply chain, but also to recognize that how quick you're able to react and respond to a solution is just as important. I remember when COVID first hit, I told my team, we can't spend too much time admiring the problem. It's you know, tremendous. Decisive decision making is extremely important, and understanding exactly what implication you're dealing with, deploying whatever mitigation strategies you can to address that. But then I would also say, it's very important to take a step back. And that's something my leadership has done multiple times over the past few years. Take a step back from the tactical execution that you're doing and learn from what we've experienced. What tools, processes, procedures can we put in place that will enable us to be more efficient and effective the next time that we're dealing with a disruption? So I think it's that combination of quick reaction to a disruption, but then learning from it and putting into place tools and processes that can help the next time.
Sure. And up to this point, both of you have mentioned, you know, the importance of building resilience into a supply chain at the design stage. I mean, that the same goes for sustainability as well, doesn't it? You have to design it into your supply chain at the design stage. I was just wondering, Kevin, how can companies best make sure that they're doing that at the design stage? What kind of procedures and practices can help companies embed resilience and sustainability, for that matter, in the supply chain as early as the design stage?
Yeah, I think companies have to be purposeful in terms of, you know, do they really want to do that? It's very natural for an engineer to look to kind of, you know, what they've done before. And they may have a supplier or material they've used for many years, and it's tried and true, and they'll go back to that time and time again. Where if you really look at the risk around that, it could be a very a perilous type of material that is difficult to get already. It might have an end-of-life component to it as well. Or it could be a supplier in a particular region that is strained too. So what we've done is set up a R&D procurement function who really is embedded with the R&D team. They'll work on helping select the material and the supply base around the future product that we're looking to market. And with that work, they can do dual sourcing, they can do dual manufacturing, whole host of things to really gain the visibility in terms of what could lead to this being a problem downstream. I think it's very common that, you know, we, along with some of our peers, have a new product that's developed, brought to market, only to find that the manufacturing team is now struggling day one to really continue to manufacture it in mass. So that's a really key critical area that a company has to be serious about moving forward with.
And I just wondered, actually, maybe you could take this question in turn. Lynn, if you were going to give a company one piece of advice about how they can become more resilient, what would it be?
I think every organization really needs to look at the goals that they're trying to achieve. What is it that in their particular marketplace and their competitive environment really differentiates them from their competition and drives their business? Once that is understood, then the appropriate supply chain strategy can be deployed to meet those goals. One thing I also like to highlight to organizations is there's a cost in driving a resilient supply chain. And I'll go back to one of my first statements. Historically, our supply chains were built on low cost and efficiencies. And as Kevin said, it was a procurement strategy to drive that to the lowest cost. Having a resilient supply chain strategy does not equal having the lowest cost available in a particular region and expect that cost to be achievable in every region. So there has to be an understanding of the goal of an organization in driving their supply chain, and then an openness to understand the cost associated with truly developing and deploying a resilient supply chain.
Yeah, I guess that what you've said there, Lynn, very insightful. It also reflects the fact that procurement has taken on a more strategic function, hasn't it, since before the pandemic. And Kevin, what about you? You know, if I'm the CEO of a company with a, you know, multinational supply chain, and I'm asking you, Kevin, if there's one thing I need to do to make our supply chain more resilient, what would it be?
I think it's really based on transparency. So again, we've been talking a lot about kind of pre-pandemic. Pre-pandemic, I think it was very easy for us to really defer to the tier one, you know, a Flex as an example, where, you know, trusting that they were going to manage the entire end-to-end supply chain for us. I think what we've seen with, you know, COVID now is that 80% of our supply issues haven't been with a tier one supplier, but with a tier N. And not having visibility to that, it was very difficult then because we weren't managing them. I think that's the one thing that I see as critical as we go forward, to make sure that companies know who their tier end suppliers are, which ones are critical, which ones do you have to manage as well. That's going to help then build the agility, I think, in terms of our total supply chain, where we may have been buying, you know, feedstock from a very strained supplier in a third world nation that we didn't know about. Now we can create a mitigation plan to dual source it, to increase safety stock, a whole host of things that can really, I think, build a more resilient supply chain here.
Sure. And that advice that you've both given there, that sector independent and business independent, that's something that any company could deploy and apply to their business model.
Yeah, absolutely.
And let's turn our attention to your own companies. So, Lynn, you know, what is it that's happening at your company in terms of building resilience and trying to navigate all this uncertainty and turmoil that seems to be never ending?
Yeah, well, certainly at Flex, our supply chain strategy has always been one of our strategic pillars of the organization. I think that what we've seen recently is supply chains becoming strategic for every organization as they've looked towards those challenges. At Flex, we build product for our customers and help them, you know, from design activity through their manufacturing selection strategy through end of life.
So, can I just ask you to maybe let our listeners and viewers know what kind of products it is that your company produces, Lynn?
Well, we produce a wide range of products. As I said, we manufacture for other companies, including Kevin's, is a valuable customer of ours. But we have six business segments that we look at. So we are in the automotive sector, health solutions, industrial, cloud business, consumer devices, and lifestyle. I think I hit the switch there.
Great.
So, so we have about 1,000 customers that we manufacture their products for, and we run 1,000 different supply chains to work with them. But what we're doing now is we work with our valued customers as they're looking towards driving resiliency into their supply chain. We offer them services and solutions. We have our preferred supplier base and an extensive knowledge about supplier performance that we'd like to share with our customers so that when they're looking at partners that they want to work with, they can leverage the information that we have. And so, and we also have our design expertise where we offer alternatives and solutions from an engineering aspect. We also have tools that help with that with the manufacturing selection process. I mentioned earlier what makes sense for a company using a single location of a flex manufacturing facility to take advantage of, you know, that scale and scope, or does a multi-regional distribution strategy work? We actually have a tool called SimFlex, which is able to take in all of the considerations that would go into making those type of determinations, including, you know, taxes that would be paid and freight costs that would be involved to help with that decision-making process for our customers. So we really look at trying to bring our expertise and knowledge and enable our customers to make good choices. And finally, I'd like to mention our Pulse system. Digitalization of supply chains is incredibly important. And at Flex, we're very fortunate because we started this journey in 2015, where we moved to our digitalizing our supply chain. So we call it our Pulse system. It's embedded in the entire organization. We have Pulse, nine Pulse centers around the world that where we bring people together to do ideation sessions. It's also available on everybody's laptop or telephone, and you're able to see the global supply chain in real time for Flex. So if I have a customer, I can see how we're performing at a global level. I'm able to very quickly drill down to a part number level to see if there's a shortage and we're trying to pull that in, what was the very last conversation with the supplier that took place anywhere in the world, and I have that detail at my fingertips. Digitalization of supply chain is also very important, and it's something that we have available to offer to our customers.
Great, thanks. And so just one quick supplementary question there, Lynn. Is that something that you were working on before COVID struck, or is that something that has been prompted by all the disruption that followed from that?
No, in fact, we had our Pulse Center, we started that journey in 2015. Okay. So in fact, it's well embedded as part of our business. And it was something that we utilized from the very beginning to help us respond to all of the supply chain disruptions we had, because it is the single source of the truth and the entire organization has access to it. We were able to come up with strategies, deploy them, create specific Pulse dashboards to help us monitor our progress and continue to innovate through there. So I feel very fortunate that I had the Pulse center and processes to help navigate through such a challenging time.
Thanks for that, Lynn. And Kevin, what about at Becton Dickinson? How are you building, you know, resilience into your company?
Yeah, so I think, you know, maybe the similarities with what Lynn shared too, but, you know, we're in a highly regulated, validated industry. So you can't just go to a different supplier, different material without going through a lot of testing and so forth. So, you know, really it's around getting that visibility up front and making sure that you can do the complete assessment on the product line in every bill of material. That allows us to really have that good discussion with our business units in terms of, you know, where do we see risk happening here? What do we need to do differently? An example I would use is, you know, 5 or 6 years ago, having a global supply chain that you could really depend on for just-in-time manufacturing really isn't the case right now. Maybe that comes back to viable again. But today, when you have, you know, ocean containers that can take 45 to 100 days, it's very difficult to run a just-in-time manufacturing plant. So we've had to take on a larger safety stock of raw materials as well. So what that has done is it's created more of a regional sourcing and regional manufacturing program to really try to drive the agility that way. And you can't have everything in a region in terms of where you source it, but there's a lot of things that you can do to improve it. So we've really been taking that approach here. And then again, the visibility to make sure that the company is aware of what risks are out there really is step one in making sure it can manage it going forward.
So, I mean, risk comes in all shapes and forms, doesn't it? There's always been risk. Some of it is known, some of it's unknown. But if you're building resilience, I mean, if you are building resilience against one particular type of risk, I don't know, say geopolitical uncertainty, seeing now war in Ukraine, you know, China posturing over Taiwan, is the approach you take with something like that different to the resilience you need to overcome exactly what Kevin was talking about there, delays in container shipping times? Or is it a one-size-fits-all approach to risk, Lynn?
Yes, certainly risk is not a one-size approach to all, because each potential element that can bring risk to a supply chain needs to be considered independently, so that you're looking at, as Kevin mentioned, there's freight and logistics challenges that have occurred and are still being very disruptive. So then is it lead times that you put in? So you're taking into consideration the lengthening lead times of products or the different transportation modes that take place. If you're looking at disruptions because of the war in Ukraine, what products are you sourcing that come from that region, or what supply chains typically would transport through that region that need to be looked at for either a different source of supply or different routing, and what that takes into consideration. And you know, when you think the zero China COVID policy that has impacted numerous times as cities have been shut down, that's a bit more difficult to potentially predict because it happens quite quickly. But you know, you're typically looking at what is coming out of those regions that might be impacted and what can be done to potentially solve that. What we've seen a bit at Flex is, you know, they're really trying to, you know, understand that in some cases, some additional inventory is appropriate so that you're able to mitigate some of those risks. But one of the other challenges that we've seen that has highlighted from all of the disruptions we've had is really a challenge in forecasting of demand, and then which impacts the ability to, you know, supply the products. And this is not the first cycle I've been through in my career. It's certainly the most significant, but I think as an industry, we need to look for ways in which we are able to better forecast demand throughout the entire ecosystem and work a little bit more collaboratively with customers, suppliers, distributors, EMS partners, so that we're able to, I guess, get a better picture of the true demand by using the information and data we have available to us in slightly different ways than we have in the past.
Thank you for that, Lynn. And so, Kevin, you know, your company will manufacture lots of products with microprocessors in them. How have you been able to sort of build resilience around that problem? Because it's ongoing and it doesn't look like it's going to ease anytime soon.
Correct. Yeah. And I think on top of that, you know, one of our platforms is really to move to more connectivity. So we have a number of products that are already dealing with microprocessors and electronics, but our future is going in that direction as well. So combine that with the fact that it's already difficult to get that based on the demand around the world, and now we're looking to buy more. So that's really required a different way to operate and manage, you know, these product profiles. And that is working with the companies like Flex and the direct manufacturers to make sure they understand that, you know, we're a healthcare company, critical to healthcare products that we're making here. How do we get some prioritization to make sure that product is coming and getting directed to us as well? It does come back to the demand and forecasting. And in healthcare, you know, we're notoriously not very good at forecasting demand. You know, you have IDNs and hospitals around the world that, you know, use a certain amount depending on the number of procedures that they're doing. We also have more at-home care being done. Very difficult to forecast there. So how do we give an accurate forecast to our suppliers like Flex and others out there so they can make enough in advance as well? I think last time I heard microprocessors had a lead time of, you know, 24 months and, you know, we're probably coming down a little bit. It's very difficult to forecast that far in advance here. So quite frankly, we're having to guess at what we may need, knowing that we're going to guess wrong. And then we're going to have to partner with the upstream providers to make sure, you know, we have enough product coming in. So that's the challenge that we have going forward. The other area that we've worked on here is partnering with Washington and trying to work with them in terms of, you know, the CHIPS Act, having more manufacturing being built so it can be directed again to the industries that are in need here. That's probably a little bit longer term, but something that, you know, we look at as very helpful in the future.
And is sort of nearshoring, reshoring something you're seeing a lot more of as well, Lynn?
We are definitely seeing companies want to explore options for nearshoring, reshoring, friendshoring. There's lots of terminology today that's being used. But certainly as companies are looking at those disruptions that have occurred in the past and potentially looking at, you know, that multi-regional strategy or getting closer to end markets, we are seeing companies explore reshoring options with Flex, which for us, we're in quite a nice position, actually, because we have a very broad global footprint. So we're, you know, we can support our customers from a manufacturing location to meet their needs. And I do think that, you know, being able to provide that and be with our customers on that journey is, you know, important as they're coming up with their strategies for how they want to work towards the future. And Kevin, I'll mention one thing. You mentioned being historically bad at forecasting. I think everybody's pretty bad at forecasting when it's expected to be out 2 years from now or 18 months. And that is a challenge for all of us to try and work through together.
Sure. And, you know, you've referenced it numerous times already, Lynn, the importance of technology, sort of data-driven decision-making, you know, end-to-end supply chain visibility. But I also read an awful lot about digital transformation projects, so vital for resilience, failing for one reason or another. I think the latest McKinsey report suggested that as many as a third of all digital transformation projects either don't make it to completion or they fail entirely. So, I mean, I'd just be interested, Kevin, is this something that you've come across? And, you know, do you have any ideas around how businesses can best digitally transform?
Yeah, from my perspective, I mean, we've been on a journey for a while, too. And I think there was a whole focus on, you know, getting more and more systems implemented to try to manage all the different perspectives of a supply chain. And I think now there's the focus on how do you kind of try to whittle those down and to have a more streamlined approach. You know, the Flex program, the Pulse, is something that's very interesting and unique. We, too, have a similar type of program that we use with another company that has an element of AI and machine learning. It's very helpful today in terms of understanding our supply chain. It's one of many different ways to do it. But I do think that technology is going to be, and it is the key way to really manage this effectively today. Depending on a manual process and Excel spreadsheets is just not viable. And that was made very clear when the pandemic hit as well.
Well, thank you very much for that, Kevin. And sadly, I'm afraid that's all we've got time for today. So I'd just like to thank Kevin Nelson, Becton Dixon, and Lynn Torrell of Flex, both for your time and insight. Thank you very much and good luck going ahead. And we will be back, so don't go anywhere because we'll be back with another keynote very soon on the virtual stage. Thank you very much.